to thank Rocky Mountain Anglers, Blue Ribbon Fisheries Advisory Council for sponsoring this event. We want to thank all of you for coming out tonight. This is a great turnout. We hope to have some good information for you. My name is Paul Birdsey. I'm one of the sport fish coordinators with the Division of Wildlife Resources. Drew Cushing, who's usually here for this seminar, was recently promoted to the Chief of Aquatics, and he is in a, he had a conflict tonight with another meeting. So you got the second string up here tonight. Anyway, there's a handout over here that has some information regarding some of the specific waters in the state that have walleye. And I'm just going to take a minute here to talk about probably the latest thing that we have going on right now. Many of you are aware that walleye were illegally introduced into Red Fleet Reservoir out by Vernal a few years ago. We treated that last October to remove those walleye. And the reason for that is that those walleye were fertile. They were capable of spawning. And so they would escape the reservoir. They went down into the Green River, and they were presenting a problem for the endangered fish in the Green River. And the Upper Colorado Recovery Program did a bunch of genetic testing and, in fact, found that that's what was happening. So we put together a management plan group consisting of anglers, biologists, and tried to come up with a plan that would make Red Fleet an attractive fishery and figure out what we could do out there. Well, one of the things that people felt really strongly about was having walleye in Red Fleet Reservoir. So we worked with the recovery program, and they said if we could stock sterile walleye in there, then we would be good to go. So that's what we've been working on. And some of you probably have read about the walleye collection effort that's been going on, egg collection effort that's been going on up at Willard Bay Reservoir right now. And I want to show you a couple pictures about what we've done thus far. And I can't see that screen, so I hope that you can. This is, okay, there we go. This is our new facility at our Springville hatchery. The old building on the west side of the hatchery was completely gutted and rebuilt, and the contractors did a phenomenal job. Our hatchery personnel have done a phenomenal job. This, what is shown here is the egg room. These jars, that gray stuff that you see in those jars, are walleye eggs. As of yesterday, we had about 12 million walleye eggs at the facility. However, the guys up at Willard have been doing a phenomenal job, and they've been out there 7 days a week for the last couple of weeks. And they spawned a whole bunch of walleye this morning. So as of today, I haven't gotten the final number. We're expecting that there's between 18 and 20 million eggs in the facility. So this room is probably, 40 feet long. It has the capacity in this particular area to hold about 80 of these egg jars. And I think that we've got around 50 of them with eggs in them right now. So that's a better picture of all the egg jars that we had. And each one of those egg jars has got a tube leading down from it from that big pipe, and it puts water into that jar so that the eggs are slowly rolled so they don't get fungus on them. And then when they get close to hatching, they're moved out into this other room here. And these larger tanks are filled with water, and that's where the walleye hatch into. And you can see in this picture, one of those egg jars is attached to the side of that larger tank. There's water that goes into that jar to keep those eggs moving. And then there's a little light at the top. And then the fry, when they hatch, are attracted to that light. So they swim up towards the light, and they go out in a little chute on the backside and get emptied into that larger tank. So this facility is constructed. It's only phase one right now, but it's constructed that we're going to be able to raise not only walleye in there, but we're going to be moving wipers, hybrid striped bass, in there in the next month or so. And they're going to go on into these tanks that are on the left in this picture. That's these larger tanks here. And then there's another portion of the building, which I didn't take a picture of, but it will be set up as a recirculation facility that will be able to raise wipers up to 8 or 9 inches. We'll also be able to raise channel catfish, yellow perch, whatever we want to do. Now, if any of you have been to the Springville hatchery, this is all on the west side of the highway, and you may remember that there's a series of raceways right there, old raceways outside. In phase three, those raceways will be completely demolished, and we'll be building buildings out there, and they're going to be set up as modular units. We're going to start out with one, and as we get more money, we're going to just keep adding to it, and those will all be recirculating hatchery facilities. That the estimate right now is that within the building that I just talked about here, we'll be able to raise 44,000 pounds of warm and cool water fish. And by the time the facility is all done, we'll be somewhere up around 200 to 250,000 pounds of warm and cool water fish for the waters in the state of Utah. So, does anybody have any questions about that? Yes, sir.
How does the eggs get fertilized?
We fertilize them out on the, we take males and females, and we strip the eggs and the milt there and fertilize the eggs right at Willard Bay. And then in order to make them sterile, we have to subject them to pressure. So we have essentially a big pressure cooker there, and they get cranked up to 9,000 pounds of pressure for about 10 minutes. And we ship the first batch out. Now, we can only stock them into Red Fleet if they're 100% sterile. That's the rule. So we shipped out the first batch to Virginia Commonwealth University this morning. They're going to be doing the testing. We should have the test results back tomorrow afternoon. And if all goes as planned, the first batch of walleye fry will go into Red Fleet Reservoir on Friday. Yes, sir. The question is, how long do they take to get to catchable size? Walleye grow very fast. We anticipate that they'll be about 11 to 13 inches by this fall, and pushing 18 inches sometime next summer. Yes, sir.
What's the survival rate on eggs to fry?
What's the survival rate on the eggs to fry? Well, that's a really good question that we're still trying to figure this out. We are total newbies at this. What we can see is that between the first batch of eggs that we took and the batch that we've most recently taken, it seems like we have less mortality. However, the process of making them sterile causes some mortality also. So, but we anticipate to get somewhere around 30% or so of the eggs to fry. That's what we're hoping for anyway. Yes, sir. This, sir. Yes, no, you need to contact the hatchery personnel, and the reason for that is because we're very concerned about disease getting into our hatchery, so we want to make sure that we have controlled access at all time in there. Yes, sir. Okay, great question, because I just learned this yesterday. How do you know the fish are sterile? So what we do is we send them off to Virginia Commonwealth University. They take about 200 of them. They put them in a saline solution, a saltwater solution, and then they mash them up. And then they add a dye to that mashed up fish parts that stains the DNA in the fish. Now, a triploid fish, that is a sterile fish, has 50% more DNA than a diploid fish. So then we run it through this machine that measures how much light is given off by that stain, fluorescence. And so in theory, if we have 100% triploid fish in that batch, it will give off 50% more fluorescence than the fish that are fertile. Let me get him first. Yes, sir. Yeah. Okay, the question is, what do they feed the fry when they're in the hatchery? We don't. We stock them out in the first 5 days when they still have their egg sac, so that we don't need to put them on feed. There are plenty of studies that show that if we can get them out in the first 5 days before they absorb that egg sac, they have a better chance of survival once we stock them out than if we wait. No, we don't. We do not wait until they're fingerlings. We get them out as quickly as we can. The mortality rate once we get them in the lake is very high, as you might expect. But I think the quota for Red Fleet is 2 million fry. Of that, we probably expect to, you know, see something in the neighborhood of, you know, 1,000 to 2,000 survive, which is plenty for that little body of water. The rest of the walleye, so we have plenty of places on the list that we're going to go to. We're going to go to Big Sand Wash, and I'm trying to go from memory here, so forgive me if I miss something. Willard Bay's on the list to get some back, but they'll be fertile walleye. We didn't treat those. Deer Creek is on the list. Yuba. Starvation. Thank you. So assuming that everything works, you know, wonderfully, that's the list. Let me get this guy back here first, real quick. Okay, so how do we know that they're sterile? Well, we have this process where we look at them through that machine for this. There's also blood tests that can be done, which are done for the rainbow that go into strawberry. We subsample those fish. I think we take a sample of 100 of those. We do the blood test on them. We do not stock them into strawberry unless they're 100% sterile. The fish that you see in strawberry, the rainbow that you see in strawberry that have the cutthroat or appear to have the cutthroat trout markings aren't necessarily an interbreeding with the cutthroat. They're just a different coloration of the rainbow. Rainbow and cutthroat are very closely related, and you get a lot of morphological characteristics that appear in both of those species. Okay, there's a gentleman up here. Yes, sir. Then the question is, what level of reproduction do we get from fertile walleye? It's very low. We actually get probably better survival from egg to fry in our hatcheries than we do in the naturally. So that's one of the reasons why hatcheries were invented, is because we can do a better job than they can, give them a better chance than they can get out in the wild. One all the way in the back. Okay, are they susceptible to whirling disease and some of the other diseases that trout are? No, they are not. They have their own set of parasites that they're susceptible to. Okay, I need to take maybe one more here. I am not, what other parasites do they get? I am not a parasitologist. I can just tell you that they get something. Okay, sorry about that. That's the best I can do for you. Okay, one last one. Yes, sir. Does Red Fleet have the appropriate forage fish for walleye to do well? It's getting there. We've stocked perch. We will be stocking black crappie in there. I believe that bluegill are also on the list of species to go back in there. So we've thought, again, with the help of the anglers, we've thought long and hard about what species mix we want to go back in there. And yeah, it might be a little bit predator heavy, but we'll balance it out as we move forward. Okay, thank you very much. Our next speaker today is Marty Burt with Scheels. And
all right, can you guys all hear me? All right, so what I want to talk to you guys today about is sonar and how to use sonar to help you locate and catch more walleye. So I'll tell you a little bit about myself before we get started. My name is Marty Burt. I'm one of the fishing managers down there at Scheels. I grew up in Duchesne, Utah. I grew up just a couple miles from starvation. And just so you know, there's no fish in starvation, so don't even bother trying. Just kidding. So I grew up fishing. If you've ever been to Duchesne, there's not much really there to do besides fishing. So I love to fish and have done quite a bit of it. So what I want to talk today is sonar and different types of sonar. If you ever walk into our store, into Cabela's, you're going to see 20 different units, and they're all going to have different features. So I want to kind of cover the features so you know what you're looking for and what you're getting when you're buying a unit and how to use it to help you catch more walleye. So things I want to cover is 2D sonar, what that is, what chirp sonar is, down imaging, side imaging, how to use the GPS and the maps that a lot of your sonars come with, and some possible different units that are good buys. So 2D sonar, what is 2D sonar? Definition I found, a system for the detection of objects underwater and for measuring the water's depth by emitting sound pulses and detecting or measuring their return after being reflected. So what you have your boat, you have your fish finder on there. You mount your transducer on the back of it, and it's going to emit sound waves. Whenever those sound waves hit anything in the water, they turn around and reflect back, and then it's portrayed on your fish finder screen. It could be fish. If you have a sensitivity turned up, it can be dirt in the water that it's going to reflect off of. And then obviously the bottom. So you're seeing what's in the water, what depth it's at, and what's on the bottom of the lake. So this is a pretty standard screen that you're gonna get with your 2D sonar. So there's kind of a lot going on. I kind of want to explain what you're seeing here and be able to pick out the information that you need. So there's a couple things with the screen to help you to understand what it is. So the first thing is gonna be the RTS window. That bar there on the right side, that's the real-time sonar window. So what that is, as it shoots the sound down, whatever's reflected back is portrayed in that window, and that's what's happening below you at that second. That's what's directly below your transducer. This big box you have out to the left with all the arcs and all the nice colors in it, that's gonna be the history of the RTS window. So that's what you've already passed. That's where you can see, you know, arcs that show up as fish. That's where you can see, you know, the bottom, other things that show up. That's going to be the history or what you've already gone over. So obviously that's the top of the water column there, the yellow on top. You can see the bottom. And then this arc here, you know, your fish are going to show up as arcs. They're not going to show up. You can make them show up as a little fish symbol, but generally they're going to show up as arcs on your sonar screen. So to kind of explain that, to show you why you're looking for arcs for fish, got this little diagram here. So you've got your beam, which is going down as a cone. When a fish first swims into the cone, or when your boat first goes over the cone, it's barely reading that fish. It's maybe one getting its head or its tail, so it shows up very small. As the fish swims into the beam fully, it's gonna get a little bit thicker, and then as it swims out of the beam, it gets smaller again. As well as when it first swims into the beam, in this diagram, it's 14 feet away. Swims into the middle of the beam, it's 13 feet away from your transducer, then 14 feet out as it swims out. So your fish is going to show up as a nice arc. If you're getting nice arcs, those are fish. That's something to look for with your fish finder. To kind of talk a little about the sonar beam or the cone that it emits. Generally, with most of your fish finders, there's two different cone angles you can use. There's an 83 kilohertz and a 200 kilohertz. The 83 is going to be a wider beam, the 200 is going to be narrower. We'll get a little bit more into the pros and cons of each of those. So one of the issues that you can run into when you're sonar fishing is uneven ground and the sonar beam having a hard time picking up fish off of drop-offs or off of ditches. So here in this, you can see, you know, that it's 15 feet deep, you've got fish off of a drop-off, but that sonar's you really can't pick it up because it's catching the top of that ridge, and it's reflecting so much noise back that it really can't pick up very well what's down below there. So walleye, a little bit about them, you know, they're generally eating minnows. They're waiting to ambush their prey. They hang out near the bottom and, you know, points, drop off rocks, piles, something that can provide them cover that they can kind of, you know, run out and snatch a minnow as it swims by. That's generally kind of where walleye are hanging out. So with your sonar, it can be kind of challenging sometimes to mark your walleye. You know, if they're right off a drop-off, if they're in a ditch, if they're in a rock pile, you'll see that rock pile. You can see a drop-off on your sonar, but it'd be hard to mark specific fish. And that's where that cone angle really comes into play. So if you're fishing a drop-off, if you have that 83 kilohertz beam, that real wide beam, it's gonna be catching the top of that ridge and you're really not gonna see much. If you run that narrower beam, you know, you're fishing off a drop-off, it's gonna shoot off that drop-off, it's going to pick up more of those fish that are holding there. The downside of that is obviously you're covering less water. You're not seeing as much as what's down below your boat. So the 200 is going to show fish better in that situation. The 83 will show less water, or the 83 will show more water but less detail in drop-offs. So 2D sonar, you can use it to locate fish, locate bait fish, sea depth, and sea bottom contours. So now we get a little bit into chirp. Chirp's kind of a phrase that's been thrown around a lot. Everyone always talks about chirp, but not a lot of people really know what it is. So I want to talk about chirp sonar and how it can help you locate even more fish than just your regular 2D sonar. So according to the Garmin website, it says chirp sends a continuous sweep of frequencies ranging from low to high. Chirp sonar technology then interprets frequencies individually upon their return. Since this continuous sweep of frequencies provides chirp with a much more wider range of information, chirp sonar is able to create a much clearer, higher resolution image. Kind of a mouthful, but we'll go over it a little bit. So this is just, you know, different frequencies of waves. So 200 kilohertz would be something that you see there on your left. The 83 is going to be something on the right. So that they're two completely different frequencies of waves. There's a lot of, you know, different wave wakes and wave frequencies in between. But with your regular sonars, you're only using one of those two. And you have to, you know, set your sonar to which one you want to use. What CHIRP does is it covers, you know, 83 to 200 kilohertz. It covers that whole frequency range. It alternates sending, it alternates the frequencies that it uses. It gets it back, and then there's a computer in the fish finder, eliminates the noise that you don't need to see. So CHIRP is good for those situations where you're fishing drop-offs, where you're fishing ditches, where you're fishing rock piles, because having that frequency get narrower and wider on its own, you're going to see much better detail on those drop-offs, in those rock points. Anywhere that the regular sonar might have a hard time picking up, CHIRP's going to give you a much higher definition. A lot of times when you go into a store and you're looking at it, for instance, one of the Lowrance units that we sell, it has, you know, medium-high CHIRP, medium CHIRP, and low CHIRP. To help you understand what that is, you know, high CHIRP covers that high, you know, about a third of the frequency range. Medium CHIRP covers the medium, and then low CHIRP covers that lower end of the frequency range. Instead of covering all the frequencies, most of your fish finders only cover certain portions that you choose. There's only a couple fish finders that are true broadband CHIRPs that cover all the frequencies at the same time, and we'll talk a little bit more about some of those in a minute. So big deal with CHIRP is just better detail for places where walleye a lot of times will hang out. This is a screen of an 83 kilohertz versus a medium CHIRP. I mean, you see much better target separation. You can see those arcs are much more defined on that medium CHIRP as opposed to what's on the 83 kilohertz. Those have those different beams are you know, picking up those fish and giving you more positive returns. This is another image of a Lowrance CHIRP unit. You know, very, very defined bottoms and very, very defined fish. So again, it's giving you better target separation. A real big thing to focus on is on that right part of that sonar screen. Just as that ridge is coming up, you can see those two real defined arcs, as well as that ridge in the middle of the screen, just to the right of it, you can see those arcs right there off the drop-off. That's what CHIRP's gonna show you. It's gonna show you those fish that are holding real close to structure off drop-offs. Or regular 2D sonar may not be able to pick that up because it's going to get a lot of interference with that drop-off. So better target separation, better detail along drop-offs. You can see fish in or near rock piles. So again, CHIRP sonar helps you locate fish, fish holding in structure, and better target separation, as well as more power for deep water. So I want to talk a little bit about down imaging as well. So down imaging is relatively new, and it's, you know, a very useful tool for fish and fish that do relate to structure. So down imaging is the detailed images of down imaging are created with high frequency sound waves emitted in ultra thin slices. A sonar returns from these waves produce a snapshot of what's below your boat. So to kind of give you a little image of what those sonar frequencies look like, the two cones in the middle, the narrow one's obviously your 200 kilohertz beam. The wider one's your 83 kilohertz beam. Now those two kind of oval-shaped ones out to the side is going to be your down imaging. If you can see, it's a 455 kilohertz beam, so it's, you know, much more powerful beam than what your 2D sonar uses. You can also see that it's much narrower, so you're going to get a lot less return with that. And by doing this, you're able to get more detailed pictures of what's down there. So I'll show you an image. This is your 2D sonar versus your down imaging. So obviously you can see a very detailed picture of what's down there. So it does show details of structure. It's going to show you if it's a bush or a tree or rocks or what's down there. It's going to show you that. And a lot of times it's very useful for clarifying what you are seeing on your 2D sonar. 2D sonar is always going to be better for marking fish than down imaging. Down imaging has a, you know, doesn't get a very positive return on fish. But, you know, so 2D sonar is always going to be better for marking fish. If you see here, though, if you were just looking at that 2D sonar, it's kind of a mess. You know, you're not really sure what you're looking at. That could be a bush. You know, maybe it's something else. Maybe it's a huge school of bait fish. You don't really know. But with your down imaging, it clarifies that. You can see, okay, it's a bush. I don't want to troll through that because I'm probably going to lose my setup. So it's used to locate structure that can hold fish. This is another example of it. You can see that sonar on the left, there's so much return coming off just off that bottom, you really can't see what's in there. So down imaging will show fish. It's kind of hard to see, but it will show fish. Just to the right of that hump, just above the tree line, you can see, let's see if I can get a mouse on here. So right there, that's gonna be a fish right there. Your sonar's not gonna pick that up, but it's showing up that's gonna be a fish. So just to the right of that hump, those real bright dots are fish. So down imaging can be used to locate fish in structure better than 2D sonar, because 2D sonar, you can't see anything in there. Another thing too is seeing what's in, what kind of geography you're trolling over. So again, looking at that sonar, you just see the bottom as it appears directly below your boat. You just see a ridge. You can't tell if there's a drop off on the right side or what it is. You just see, you know, it's a ridge. With the down imaging, you can see on that lower section how it gets dark as it goes down and then lighter on that bottom right corner. So that's actually a little valley kind of coming through there. So you're going over a ridge, you can see it's a flat and then it descends down. That darker image is descending. So you can see, okay, there's a little bit of a depression just to the right of my boat. So it does show the geography better than what you're gonna see with 2D sonar. So show structure in greater detail. It's gonna show fish holding in structure. It shows a 3D picture versus 2D picture of the bottom and clarifies what is seen with sonar. That's the purposes of down imaging, and it's best used with sonar. So now I want to talk a little bit about side imaging and structure scan. So Hummingbird uses the term side imaging and Lowrance uses the term structure scan, but they both amount to the same thing. So side imaging and structure scan uses the same thin cone angles down imaging, but shoots it out at a wider angle, giving you a detailed picture of the structure of the bottom as far out as 240 feet to the left and to the right of your boat. So you're able to cover a lot more water. You're able to see that structure 240 feet out to the left and 240 feet out to the right of your boat. It's a very, very useful tool. So this is an image of side imaging right here. So it's kind of confusing, and we'll go over it so you can understand what you're looking at. A lot of people, when they look at this, when I show them side imaging, they have no idea what they're looking at. It's just a bunch of colors. So we're gonna go over it so you can see what you're looking at. So there's five or six things you need to understand when you're looking at this. So the first of all is boat location. Where are you at in relation to what you're seeing? So you can see that line directly down the middle. That's the path that you've taken. And obviously the top of the screen is where you're at right now. So the top middle is where your boat's at. Everything behind you is reflected on this screen. So then the water column. So that line down the middle is the top of the water column. You've got the dark part in the middle on either side. That's going to be the water column below your boat. You can see where it gets light on the left and on the right. That's the ground directly below your boat. And then it's the ground to the left and then the ground to the right, out to as far as you want, out to 240 feet. Most of the time you want to keep it around 120 on either side. That's going to give you the best returns, but you can set it out to 240 feet. So bottom profile, you can kind of use this in place of down imaging as well. All of your units that come with side imaging also come with down imaging. But with this, you don't even need to have your down imaging screen pulled up because, you know, if you're looking at the left or looking at the right, that's gonna give you the same picture, but down imaging is just in a little bit different way. So you can see the bottom, you can use this instead of down imaging. So to kind of show you what you're looking at and helping you pick out features, you can see out to the left how it's just kind of a straight, consistent color. That's going to be a flat terrain. So you got, you know, just a nice flat out to the left of your boat. Descending terrain, so the very left of the screen, kind of towards the top, down to the middle, you can see how it's starting to get darker. So that's where the terrain's starting to descend. So there's a little bit of a drop off over there. And then rising terrain, so down towards the bottom on the right, you can see where it's a real light line running through there. That's going to be a ridge facing you, so it's rising. It's going to give you a real positive, real bright return. And it also shows you other objects. So there on the left, you can see, you know, some logs that are sitting there, some rocks. Down on the bottom right, you can see a little valley with some logs in there. So you're really able to see the structure and see what's out there, see what's on either side of the boat. So I'm going to cover a little bit about GPS and maps. GPS shows the location on the lake. With GPS, you have the ability to mark locations where you have caught fish. And that's a huge thing right there. I want to stop right there. So, you know, when you catch a fish, it's always a good idea to mark your location on your GPS where you've caught that fish. So it says, pairing that with maps of lakes gives you the ability to search out certain features such as points, drop-offs, and flats. It helps you recognize patterns that will help you locate and catch more fish. So let's say you've caught four or five fish. Let's say you've marked each one when you've caught it. You can go back and look at those points. You can say, okay, every time I troll past a rock pile, I hook up. Or every time I troll off a drop-off, troll next to, you know, an old riverbed, I hook up on a fish, hook up on a walleye. Having that GPS, having the ability to mark those points, and having good lake maps to see the structure, the contours of the lake, it can help you, you know, find the pattern, find out what the fish are doing, and allow you to repeat that, allow you to hook up on more fish. Another nice thing, any of your site imaging units are going to have a GPS built in. One of the neat things is, let's say you're consistently catching fish off of points. Again, kind of down on the bottom right there, you can see a point sticking out. With your site imaging, you actually run your cursor over to that point and you can hit mark. What that does is that's going to mark a waypoint on that point right there. So on your map, it's going to pop up, you know, back behind you, now to the right, waypoint one was created. And you can go to that waypoint, it's going to put you right on top of that point. So using structure scan with your GPS, you know, you can find the patterns and use that pattern that you found to locate more fish. So a lot of your finders are only going to come with the basic, just generic lake maps that are on there. There's a couple lake maps that you can get that are, you know, much more versatile. They're going to show you a lot more information. One of them is going to be the Hummingbird Lake Master. I'm going to make them for the western states. They got about 10 lakes here in Utah. That's a good lake map if you're running Hummingbird. It's a good lake map to run with them. Another one, and probably my favorite, is from Navionics on their hot maps. A lot of the lakes in Utah, you know, Starvation, you know, Strawberry, any of those places, Navionics hot maps can give you up to 2-foot contours. You can see in real good detail what the bottom of the lake looks like. So again, you develop a pattern, you can use these maps to continue to do that pattern and hook up on more fish. So I want to talk just about a couple different sonar units that are on the market that are good buys. So the first ones are the Helix 5 series. They range from $200 to $500, depending on which ones you get. They'll do anything from just basic sonar to site imaging with GPS. So this is, you know, probably the cheapest way to get into a good fish finder. You know, if you're on a little bit of a budget, these are awesome units. The Helix 12 Site Imaging Chirp, it's a little bit more expensive, but this is one of Hummingbird's premier fish finders. It's going to do the broadband chirp that we discussed, so it's actually going to cover the 83 to the 200 kilohertz beam all the time it's running, as well as site imaging GPS. This is a very awesome unit if you want, you know, the best of the best. Another one from Lowrance is the Elite Hook 7, or Elite 7 Hook, excuse me, for $450. This is one of the better buys for walleye fishermen. So it's going to show you 2D sonar, chirp, as well as down imaging. You don't get the side imaging with it, but the chirp that you get with this for $450 is very, very useful. It's one of the best chirps on the market for under $1,000. Another one to consider is the Elite 7 Total Imaging for $800. This one will do everything the Elite 7 hook well, as well as side imaging. So these are some good units to consider if you're wanting to get a unit. So just to recap, it's kind of hard to go out in the lake and just blindly fish and catch walleye. You know, having the ability to see what's down there, having the ability to know where you're out in the lake is very, very useful for catching these fish. Another thing as well, let's say you're marking tons of walleye, you're trolling past them, you're jigging for them. They're not biting. You know there's fish down there, but they're not biting. Maybe it's time to change your bait. So sonar is awesome for locating fish, and you know it's going to help you hook up on more. And once you learn to use them, they're pretty easy to learn once you get on the water. But I would definitely recommend, you know, fishing with sonar of one type or another. And yeah, that's all I have. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Question. So he asks if any of these units are interchangeable for ice fishing. So ice fishing to your boats. The Helix 5 is probably the most versatile out of all those. The Hummingbird does sell a Helix 5 ice kit. Comes with an ice transducer in a case for a couple, like $150 extra dollars. They're probably the most versatile as far as open water and ice fishing, kind of filling the gap, filling the need for both. So yeah, thank you guys. Oh, one more question, okay. It will. So they'll show up as a kind of a brighter little dot. Again, you're not using your imaging, your down your side imaging so much for marking fish. 2D sonar is always going to be 100 times better for marking fish. What it is it's used for locating structure that's going to hold fish. You know, you develop a pattern, you're catching fish off drop-offs, you're catching fish next to rock piles. You can use that side imaging to locate those places that are going to hold fish, and then get to it. And then obviously you're gonna use your 2D sonar to mark the fish. So either one of those, the down imaging, the side imaging, you're gonna want to use in tandem with your sonar.
You didn't mention anything about, I know it's like newer, like a 360 imaging, what kind of feedback is there on that?
So 360 imaging, something a little bit different. The downside of 360 imaging is it doesn't work very good when you're moving. You can use it when you're moving, but it doesn't give you a very good return. What it is it's a transducer that drops in the water and spins at 360 degrees and gives you that imaging, gives you that same side imaging, but in a complete circle in front of you as well as behind you. Downsize doesn't work when you're moving very well, as well as it's pretty expensive to get into. The transducer is almost $3,000 for it, so it's a pretty pricey piece of equipment to have on your boat that isn't as useful as you think it would be. If you got money to spend, it's a pretty cool piece of technology. But I wouldn't really say it's going to be much more useful than what side imaging is going to do for you. I'm sorry? Okay. So you can like scroll back and see in 3D, yeah. Yeah, so there's some pretty neat stuff out there. Lowrance is definitely coming out some awesome stuff this year for helping to locate fish. But yeah, I think he's kicking me off now. So if you have any questions, you can come talk to me after and I'll do my best to answer them. Or, you know, come into to us and we can talk to you in the store at Scheels. But thank you guys.
Thanks, Marty. I don't want to cut Marty off because it's really interesting. I just learned a lot myself. But we do have a full program, want to keep people moving here. We've got Eljay Gibson coming up here next. Eljay's going to talk to us first about some bottom bouncing, and I don't think you had a PowerPoint, is that correct? Okay, so Eljay's going to talk about bottom bouncing for walleye, and then a little bit later he'll talk about some night fishing techniques.
Everybody hear me? Good. I'm going to talk a little bit about my favorite way to catch walleye. Bottom bouncing. I come from Idaho and I was always a trout fisherman, and walleye are a real challenging fish to catch. I know a lot of people give up on them and go back to catching trout, but if you ever master it, you won't want to catch any trout again, I tell you that. But you need your good pole with a real sensitive tip and a big backbone. I use level wind reels because they get down there quicker. Sometimes that's important. And you don't need to put leader on your line. I use 8-pound fire line on all my reels. You never have to re-spool. I've had some of the same line on reels for going on six years and never had to re-spool. They even say you can take it off and turn it around. I've never done that, but you need to attach it to a swivel. Snap swivel is what I use, and then you can take the bottom bouncer. I use, they come in various lengths, but I use 2 ounce, and that allows you to fish from 14 foot to 70 feet. And so you can have all the different kinds of, you want on your boat, but I mostly use 2 ounce, and if it gets a little bit windy, I might go to 3, but the key is to getting your bait on the bottom, because walleye are a bottom fish. So you're in your boat, and you're fishing with your electric, and you drop your bottom bouncer down there until it hits the bottom, and just, some people like it ticking on the bottom like that. I like to pull it up just an inch or so off the bottom and put it in the rod holder, and I use what they call smile blades. I use probably these more than any other blade out there, and there's a reason for that. They're real light. They're made out of some kind of plastic, and you can get down to like 0.4 mile an hour and that blade will still spin. Where a metal blade, you got to get up around 1 over 1 mile an hour. And you can buy them at Mac Lures. I tie up my own rigs. State of Utah, you can use 3 hooks. I've done some fishing with 3 hooks, but I like 2 the best. Make your own. It's kind of interesting to make something and put it down there and have fish bite it. But this is my favorite killer anywhere I go. It's chartreuse with black flake. Don't tell anybody about it, or there won't be any walleye left. And the thing to yes. Oh, I'll see. You want to see it? I got some for sale for $5. Anyways, you can make your own bead killers. I use just something different all the time. And you put it down you drop it down so, like I say, it hits the bottom. And you turn your electric on. And you go, you know, I can catch walleye. I was down at Lake Powell 2 weeks ago, and I was catching them in 70 feet, which is pretty rare. 20 to 30 feet is about the best place to, the best depth to catch them. You drop it over the side of the boat, and the key is to don't let your line out any more than 45 degrees. Straight up and down would be best, but you're moving, so you're not going to achieve that unless you got 6 ounces on it. But no more than 45 degrees. If you get too far out there, then your bottom bouncer lays down, and then you're snagged up, and you get all PO'd, and then you're back to trout fishing. I've seen a lot of guys do it, believe me. But you go along, and you'll have your bottom bouncer down there. And a lot of times you'll only see the pole load up. It won't go like that, like trout do, but you'll just see it load up, like go down like that. And you know you got something on it. And a lot of times they're just mouthing it. So what you want to do is when you see that happen, don't jerk like crazy on it. Just swing it like that, and then you hook the carpet. I do that every time. Anyways, you just swing it, and well, first let me back up a little bit. When you see that going on right there, you know there's something after it, so you feed him some line, first of all. And he's got 2 choices. He's going to eat it, or he's going to swim off. If you think he's still there, then rather than jerk it like crazy, you just kind of swing your rod a little bit like that, and you'll usually get him, and then reel him in. And what's neat about bottom bouncers, it's if you don't like just fishing for bottom bouncers, it's a really, really good way to locate fish. And a lot of times, where there's one, there's many. So if you can... got to watch my time here before I get kicked out of here. You can, you have choices. When you catch one, you can You can either go up and back and forth in that same area, maybe 50, 60 yards, and if there's more there, you'll get them. Or if you have a, I bought this new electric motor a couple of years ago. It's called iPilot. It has a really nice feature where when you catch a fish, you can push a button and it runs off GPS signal, and it'll back you up right where you push the button, so you can stop there and get your other rod out with a jig head on it, a night crawler, and jig them, and that's a really productive way to fish them. Like I say, you can fish them in 14 to 70 feet, but the key is no more than 45 degree angle on your bouncer. And whole night crawler, you get your night crawler and you got two hooks. I don't know if you can see them. I used to use three, but they're kind of a pain in the butt to tie three. But you stab the top hook in the head of the night crawler, and then you stretch it out, and then you stab the second hook. So that night crawler's, if you get some big ones, I got a friend that buys them up in Bountiful, we call them snakes. They'll be like 12 inches long. Now, that's got to be tempting to a walleye, 12-inch snake swimming around in the water. But the key is to having it fully length like that. And it's really, really a challenging way to catch fish. I love it. Like I say, I love walleye fishing altogether. And the sensitive rod tip and the backbone, level wind reel, spinner rig, smile blades is my favorite. I tie my own up, so I've got every color they make. Sometimes people say color doesn't mean nothing, but it does. If that blade there ain't catching fish, you just well go home. Seriously. But you got to have all the arsenals. Sometimes black works, sometimes red works, green, blue, black. Black works real good at Lake Powell. I was there a couple weeks ago and just slaughtered the walleye. It's a good thing there's no limit there, because there's millions of them in there, I ain't kidding you. And from now till the middle of May, they spawn. They're probably about done spawning now. 2 weeks ago, some had spawned and some hadn't, but by the end of, towards the end of April, they'll be what they call post-spawn, and they'll be looking for food, because they haven't had any for a while, because they've been devoting all their time to spawn. And then we had a tournament there, Lake Powell, I think it was 3 years ago, and we all was up by Tickaboo Canyon. It looked like 23 miles upriver, but I think four boats in an 8-hour period caught over 200 walleye, just with bottom bouncers, back and forth. So it does work. And for a leader, I use a fluorocarbon line because it's invisible, and it's a pretty sturdy line. P line is what I use. I mean, there's a lot of different kinds out there, but I like P line and 100% fluorocarbon. Bottom bouncers, I just bought, I was down at Lake Powell and I ran out. I had to bum some from my buddy so I could fish another day, but Scheels has them on sale right now, 12 for $8, which is a bargain. And they'll even ship them to you for free. So I don't know where that kid went, but I need something. Johnny Candle told me we went to North Dakota to fish for walleye after he'd done the seminar at Scheels, and he says every spring you have them on sale, 12 for $5, but I haven't seen that yet. Is that going to happen?
I think it's next week.
Next week?
Next week.
I bought too soon, huh? I tell you what, you can never have enough of them. It's a bummer when you run out. You got to tie a rock on there or something. But any questions? Well, I've tried a lot of different lengths. That's a good question. Some people like 6, 7, 8 feet. I like 3 feet. That way it's not bouncing all around down there.
Different bodies of water still taking the same kind of lures, the same kind of setup?
Yeah, for the most part. You get down to Yuba, and I tie worm harnesses up with the steel leader because you won't keep one very long. Sometimes the northern will attack it, but yeah, for the most part. Metal blades works good down at Yuba because you can go a lot faster and they'll chase it pretty good.
You use a float with your rig sometimes?
I don't. I used to have a kid where I used to work, made them and had floats, and I don't tie any floats, but. Any other questions? Jesus.
What size is your leader? What weight?
8 pounds.
You need to repeat the question because I can't hear it on the
Oh, say, I'm sorry. Okay.
Artificial worms versus real worms.
Well, he asked what works best, artificial worms or real worms? I guarantee you, if you go to starvation when the bite's on, the perch drive you nuts. That's why I like to fish at night for them. But you better take 12 to 15 dozen. I'm serious. And you'll be lucky to have any at the end of the day. But a few years back, I got tired of playing that game, so I bought Berkeley Gulp, makes some imitating night crawlers. I used them once. They worked really well, and I've never been able to catch a fish on them since. I don't know what the deal is. But experiment. Yes, sir.
What do you feel your best pulling speed for bottom bouncing?
What he asked, what's the best speed for bottom bouncing? I start out slow, 0.5 tenths of a mile, and figure out what they like. Probably if I had to pick a speed that was the best, it'd be 0.7, 0.8 with smile blades. Now you can't troll that slow with a metal blade because it won't turn. But for smile blades, that works the best.
Any do you find that buying cold weights versus fishing night?
I'll tell you about that later on.
Okay.
He asked if it's better to fish at night, and I'll talk about that later when we talk about lights.
We're going to keep moving here. Thank you, LJ. Okay, next up we have Dan Smith. He's going to talk to us about long lining and side planers.
I think a lot of you guys recognize me. I work for Fish Tech, and I'm also on Pure Fishing's Ambassador Program, so I've done a lot of fishing. I've fished the walleye tournaments and the bass tournaments, and I just like to fish. But they want me to talk about long line trolling and side planers. So a little bit of the equipment you need for long lining, you need a good rod. The rod you need for long lining, you need a pretty good length of rod. This is a 7'6", medium light. You notice how it's got quite a bit of bend in it, got a little tip on it. Well, you don't want a heavy rod when you're long lining, because most of the time you're trolling crankbait, and they got treble hooks. And everybody thinks treble hooks are the best thing. I lose more fish with treble hooks than I do with a single hook. So you need something that's gonna have a little shock absorbent, because when that fish goes to move and run away, trying to get away from you, those treble hooks will pull out. My theory is there's 3 points on a treble hook. When that fish grabs it, you set the hook. Each one of those points is only going to go in about a third of the way. If you had one hook, all the energy would go to that one spot, and it'd go in three times as far. The other thing is, when they open their mouth, one or two of those points are coming out. So now you've only got one or two points of that hook in their mouth. Now they start shaking, they get leverage, throwing that bait back and forth, it augers out that hole, they're gone. So you need something that will cushion that. You need some cushion so they can't do that. I like a medium or a medium light rod. And I want one with a little longer rod so it's got more bend to it. That's why fly fishermen, when they're catching fish with them little teeny flies, with them little teeny hooks, they don't pull out because it's a shock absorbent. So that's what I like on rods. Now a reel, I like a bait caster reel because it has more capacity. And I'm going to use 12-pound test line. I use 12-pound test line when I'm long lining. A spinning reel will work, but you're not going to get as much line on a spinning reel as you are on a bait casting reel. The other thing, if you notice on the left, that's a trolling reel that 99% of the people around here use. I'm not saying it's a bad reel. It's a Penne. That one's a 209 Penne. Everybody that trolls lead core, that's their go-to. Because they're durable. I like the one on the right because it's got a line counter. The line counter will make a big difference. The line I use, there's a bunch of different lines that you've got. You got monofilament, you've got fluorocarbon, you got braid, you got fire line, you got lead core. I use monofilament on long lining. And the reason why is I'm back to the same thing. It stretches. So it's a shock absorbent. So I use monofilament 99% of the time. And everybody says, well, why don't you use fluorocarbon? Well, fluorocarbon's great. It has a little less stretch. The manufacturers say anywhere from 3 to 10% less stretch. But it's expensive. And a fish, when that lure's coming by, it's either got to take it or let it go. They're not looking at the line. They're not looking at anything. That thing's going to get away. I'm going to eat it now or I'm going to let it go. So the line visibility doesn't mean anything when you're trolling. This is my personal opinion. I can probably get arguments. So most of the time when I'm trolling long lining, I'll use monofilament. Now the lures. We've got different shapes. There's different forage in each lake. And some lakes are murky, some lakes are clear. Now if I'm in a murky lake, like Utah Lake, you can see that far underneath the water. That's about it. Foot and a half, 2 foot. The one on the upper left has got rattles in it. That's what I want. I want something that's making a lot of noise so that they can find it. Hits their lateral line, they can find that lure. The one on the top right is a minnow shape. Most minnows are long and slender. So if there's minnows in that lake that they're eating, perch, chubs, they're long and skinny. Now the one on the bottom in the center, that's a shad shape. Like Willard Bay, they're eating shad. That's their main forage up there, is shad. So I want a shad bait, something that resembles the shape of a shad. Here's a big question everybody asks. How deep do these lures go? When you buy them in the package, the manufacturer puts right on it how deep they go. 6 to 8, 9 to 11, 11 to 13. Take them out of the package. How do I know how deep they go? Well, most of the time, if you look at these lures, the distance from where the line tie eye is to the front of the bill, the longer that is, the deeper it goes. Also the width. Now the one on the right, on the bottom left photo, the one on the right, which is a, oh my gosh, forgot the name of it. Walleye diver. It says up to 20 feet. And if you notice that one, I got it clear to the right. There's a BB impregnated right in the bill, so that'll bring it down a little bit deeper. Now, if you notice, the one has got a 13 written on it. Now, I get it out of the box. I don't know what this was. But if when I pulled it out of that box, I put it, took a Sharpie, and I put the maximum depth on it, now I know what it is by looking at it in the box. For the I just know by looking at them, but a lot of people don't. And that's a big question everybody asks. How does this lure go? Now, like a Rapala, just a regular floating Rapala, if you notice that one, I don't have a picture of it. I should have. The line tie is actually not on the bill. That one doesn't go very deep at all. That one will go 3, 4, 5 feet. So that's one way you can tell how deep the lure goes after you take it out of the package. You take a Sharpie and write on the bill. I do it all the time. Doesn't make any difference. The fish don't care. In fact, I've got some lures that I only use in tournaments because they catch fish. You can get 5 different crankbaits. 5 of the same crankbait. One of them will outproduce the rest of them. It's just the way it was made. Just like cars. You get one that's great, you get one that's a lemon. They're both the same year. What day was they made on? If they made on a Wednesday, buy it. If it's made on a Friday or a Monday, don't buy it. I'm serious. Some of the other equipment I like to have to get back to being active. A buoy marker. The GPSs are great, but a lot of you don't have GPSs. You got a fish finder without a GPS in it. How are you going to go back to where you was? Where you caught that fish? Throw a buoy marker out. As soon as you hook a fish, throw a buoy marker out. Now you know where that is. You can see it. You can see where you're going. Physically see that buoy marker. Years ago, they didn't have GPS. What did you do? Triangulate. That's how we did it. Point here, point here, point here. Then we throw a buoy marker out. I'm old school. I still use buoy markers. If I catch a fish, out goes the buoy marker. Snap weights. Everybody's going, snap weights. Why in the heck would you want snap weights? Let's say you're using a Rapala F7, goes down 3 feet. You want to fish that down in 20 feet. How are you going to get it down there? Let out 30 feet of line, snap a weight on it, let her down. Now I'm going to go back to the line counters. This is the other thing. Line counter reels. Great. I don't know how to get back to it, but line counter reels. Why would I want a line counter? I'm trolling down the lake. I'm touching the bottom every once in a while. I look down at my line counter. Oh, 75 feet. That lure is going to hit the bottom at 75 feet. So I don't want to be dragging the bottom. I want it that far off the bottom. So I'm going to crank it back to 70 feet. That way I'm about a foot to 2 foot off the bottom. Most of the walleye are going to be down close to the bottom. Like Eljay said, they're bottom fish. They will suspend, but not very often. So I want to be in the zone, but yet I don't want to hit the bottom and snag up. So I'll reel it back to 75 feet. I catch a fish. I go back to 75 feet. Without a line counter, I'm not sure where I'm at. Trolling 4 lines. Everybody can have 2 rods in the state of Utah. They passed that law a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, whatever it was. So now there's 2 guys in the boat. You got 4 rods. You ever tried trolling four rods? Pretty quick, you got a big mess. This is another thing where that snap weight works. You troll the two out the back, the two up in the front, you put a snap weight on. So when you're trolling, it goes down and out. So when you make a turn, you don't have four lines coming around to get each other. There's two in the front and two in the back. So now you're not going to get tangled up. Snap weights. We've already talked about the snap weight. Okay, now side planers. Everybody wants to know about side planers. Everything that I talked about, trolling, long lining, works with side planers. The only thing a side planer does is it gets your lure out to the side. It makes a wider path. So instead of 12 feet going down, covering 12 feet of water, you can, it's unlimited how much you could cover. The other thing is when you're trolling in shallow water, let's say 8 feet, if the boat goes across them, it moves them to the side. So the lure goes through, they're not there. But if you got a side planer out and it's going along and you push it out to the side, if you go out 10 feet to the side, those fish move out, here comes the lure right in front of them. The way this works, you let out 70 feet. That's getting me close to the bottom. I hook this clip, I clip it on my line. What happened? I clip this on my line from my rod. Then this one, I clip on the line going to my lure. Now this one says left. So it goes on the left side. So what happens is the water catches it and pushes it out. So you just watch it. And if you want it out 30, 40, 50 feet, once it gets to wherever you want it, set your reel, put it in a rod holder. Don't try holding your rod. Not going to work. You're going to be wore out by the end of the day. These pull. Once it's going along, it'll be going along, and it'll kind of look like this. All at once, it'll go, whoosh. That's the fish or the bottom. Hopefully, it's a fish and not the bottom. And it'll start doing this. All right, you got a fish. Reel it in. Take this off. And when you take it off, don't just snap it and let the line pop. Hold the line. It's better if you have a friend with you. Take it off. Keep the tension on the line. Reel the fish in. Now this is where I use braided line. And the reason why is because you can't set the hook. This is going out here. It's going out here. You set the hook. The line's coming out like this. You're not even moving anything. Braided line has no stretch, so when they grab it, it sets the hook for you. So don't force the fish. Once you get them on braided line, just reel it in really nice and easy and slow. Take it off, reel it in slow. If they take off, give them line, bow, whatever you have to do. Because if you don't, you're going to lose the fish. But this is a great tool. All of this stuff is just tools to catch fish. Everything we're talking about is tools. Crescent wrench works, but a 9/16 box end works better. Okay? So, summary is, get you a good outfit. They've got outfits that you can buy that's reasonable. know, $75 for that outfit there, I believe that's $75. Got a line counter. The rod's great. It's designed, it says walleye right on it, so it's designed for long line trolling. You don't need to go out and spend $300 on a rod and $250 on a reel. You can get away with pretty much anything. But get whatever you can afford. Get the best thing you can afford because it'll last you longer. One more thing I didn't talk about, lead core. If you remember the trolling where you put the weight on, that's a new thing that they're doing with lead core. And it's been working. Line counter still with that lead core. Everybody says, well, it's got colors. We're back to the same thing. If we're going along there and we're hitting the bottom, we want to get within 5 feet of where we're at. You can't really tell when there's 10 yards of lead core where you're going to be. So use a line counter reel on that too. What they're doing is they're putting about 14 feet of monofilament or fluorocarbon line on the end of that lead core. So when they're trolling, they've got the 14 feet of regular line, so it isn't a great big ball down there by the lure. And that works great. So if you don't have downriggers and you want to get down deeper, that's another good way of doing it. It'll break. And then when you're doing that, let's say you're going along and you start hitting the bottom, you can do two things. You can either reel the reel up or speed the boat up. That'll, because lead will come up. When you're going slow, it sinks. When you're going faster, it pulls it up. So that's something you can do with lead core line that a lot of people don't know, is speed the boat up just a little bit and it'll pull it up off the bottom. Okay.
Can I get any time for a couple questions?
Any questions? Oh, heck, this is easy. Thank you.
Thanks, Dan. We're going to bring Eljay back up for a minute to talk about night fishing. And then after Eljay, we're going to ask our biologist, Chris Penne, to talk about Willard Bay. So,
not come on. Will it be?
He'll switch it in a second.
Oh, okay. I'm Eljay Gibson. I'm going to talk a little bit to you about my favorite time to fish is at night. You don't have to deal with water skiers, any of that. Starvation is my favorite place to night fish. The perch, they go hide. So it's really, really a very productive way to catch fish. This is called a green light. You put it in the water and you put enough weight in. This is a newer version. I used to have a 4-footer, and the guy that makes them said that the bulbs are getting hard to get, and if you drop it, it breaks. These are pretty durable. You can throw them at your buddy, hit him in the head or whatever, and they work pretty good. But just have to put a little bit of weight in the bottom. Them 4-foot bulbs, you had to put a 5-pound downrigger weight on it to get it a couple inches below the water, but man, do they put out the light. They'll shoot a beam about 40 foot deep, and you'll see a beam all the way around your boat. I have two. I put one out front and one in the back. And the principle behind them is they track plankton. If you ain't seen plankton come to your light, you give it about 10 minutes. If that ain't happening, you need to move somewhere else. Primarily, I fish in 20 to 40 feet of water with the green light. And you put it out and tie it off to one of your things on the side of your boat. Hook it up to your battery, of course. You can hook to any battery. My God, these things use so little power, you could run 4 or 5 days on one battery. And you put it in the water, and you got to have some kind of light that illuminates jigs. You got to drop a jig down there that shines with a night crawler on it. And if you find them, man, look out. Your arm will be tired after about 3 hours of jerking fish, one right after another. You won't fish with two rods, I guarantee you. You won't have time. Like that. 100 fish a night, many times. And the fellow that makes these lights, he goes above and beyond any ones I've ever seen. He puts them in a seal-tight container with a piece of clear PVC pipe. And I've seen a lot of lights. Some of them sink them clear to the bottom. These you don't have to, just barely below the surface. And they work. And that's what I like, fishing with the green lights. They work really well. This guy lives up in, I think, Clearfield. His name is Jody. He makes these lights for $225. Talk about a way to catch fish. I mean, you just anchor up, find fish. When they leave, you find you another little spot. And we used to have tournaments in Rocky Mountain Anglers. They always said that the best time to fish at night, they have a tournament every year, a nighttime tournament. They always said the best time to fish at night, or what phase of the moon, was the full moon. And one year, me as a tournament director, I said, let's try the new moon. And it was every bit as good, new moon versus full moon. The only thing about full moon, if it's out, you don't need headlamps or any of that. It's pretty bright. You can see where you're going. But night fishing is, if you haven't ever tried it, you're in for a treat. And it works. Strawberry, Lake Powell. Jeez, my God, when we first took one of these down to Lake Powell, me and my buddy, we anchored up one of them houseboats out in the buoy field. And we started catching stripers. And by midnight, you couldn't even walk in the boat. The boat was full of them. And I never want to clean that many stripers again in my life. They're fun to catch, but my God, the work comes after. That's when you want to get your electric fillet knife. It cleans fish in short order. And don't buy a cheap one. Buy the best one Rapala makes, because they're worth their money. I think it costs $80, but I've had that one for many years, and I've cleaned a lot of fish, believe me. But if you want this guy's name who makes these lights, get with me after the meeting, I'll give them to you. I told him to, you better make 20 or 30 of them, because people are going to come a-running. Yeah. But I'm going to call that short. Any questions? No questions? Good.
I got a couple in the back here, okay. Leave it off that.
Yes, sir. Green light. He asked, what's the question? What kind of light is it? Green. I see people fish with white, but green attracts the plankton. Without plankton and bait fish, you're not going to catch any fish. That was another one? That was it? Yes, sir. Anything that glows, any glow jig that you light up with a light, drop it down there. So they can see it better.
Is the green light legal in all Utah water?
Yes, it is. Wyoming, yeah. You might have a problem. He asked if it's legal in Utah, and green lights are legal in Utah.
Colorado, someplace you left from.
Yeah, we changed that, I don't know, quite a while ago to allow lights, and there's no specification on color. And part of the advantage of green light is that it penetrates deeper than most of the other colors. So you'll be able to attract more plankton. Yes, sir.
Don't most of the reservoirs around here close at 10 o'clock?
There's a number of them that do. I don't personally night fish. Eljay, have you run into a problem with the state parks closing at 10 o'clock and not being able to
just take an air mattress and sleep in your boat.
Okay.
fee.
Okay, you have it from the expert. One last question.
I think with the state parks, you can exit after 10 o'clock.
Right.
You can, okay, that makes sense. You can exit after 10 o'clock, you just can't come in. I do know that some of them, though, you have to have the overnight pass, so you better just check with the park. Okay, we're going to wrap this up here in just a minute, but it's been a long night. Room's kind of warm. Why doesn't everybody stand up in place for just a minute, stretch your legs, and then we're going to dive right into the hardcore stuff. Okay, everybody sit down, please. We're going to get started here. You learning a lot?
Yay!
Okay. So for our last presenter tonight, we're going to have Chris Penne. He's a biologist in the northern region, does a lot of work on Willard Bay as well as all the other waters in the northern region. And he's going to tell you everything you need to know about Willard, plus a little more.
Thanks, Paul. All right. I'm Chris Penne. I'm a biologist in the northern region out of Ogden. I oversee reservoirs in the northern part of the state. One of them I oversee and also fish myself is Willard Bay Reservoir. So today I'm going to talk with you about that one. Just a little bit of a roadmap about where we're going, what we're going to talk about. I'll kind of give you some obligatory reservoir info. I'm going to talk about the bathymetry of Willard Bay, which is kind of the bottom contours. I'll talk about the forage fish in Willard. I consider that also part of the anatomy or something that's going to influence how and when you catch fish. We'll go over where to catch walleye through the seasons, and then I'll give you a few updates on a few different things that we've been doing. So onto the basic reservoir info. Willard Bay is located just 10 miles north of Ogden. It's one of northern Utah's most popular recreational areas, not only for fishing, but for boating, parks, etc. It was created in 1964. It's an impoundment of the Ogden River. It was actually made from a diked off arm of the Great Salt Lake, which kind of has a lot to do with what the bottom topography looks like. It's fairly shallow and flat. What they actually did was they actually diked it off, drained all the salt water out of it, filled it up, drained it one more time to get all that salt out, and then filled it up again. And it's got a lot of surface acreage. It covers about 10,000 surface acres when full. It's got a pretty diverse species assemblage in it, but the primary sport fish that you're going to see are going to be wiper, black crappie, channel catfish, and walleye. There's many more. And I think it was Dan mentioned, gizzard shad make up the primary forage fish in the reservoir, and they have a lot of influence there. Hopefully you guys can see this with a little bit of detail. If not, I encourage you to go back and check out the presentation on YouTube since we're broadcasting on that and it'll stay up there. This is basically a bathymetric map that I got from the Bureau of Reclamation. Looks like it was done back in 2009. I tried blowing up the depth numbers and representations for you, but it still wasn't that big. So basically, to kind of get your bearings, brown and yellow are going to be the more shallow areas, and then as you fade to green and blue, those are going to be deeper. And what you can see when you look at Willard is the bottom is pretty homogeneous or similar. It doesn't change that much. You've got some areas of humps and changes in elevation over on the northeast side. You've got some on the eastern side where the South Marina and Inlet are. I'm going to see if I can get a mouse on this and it'll show up. This is the South Marina. We've got the island out here. This is about a half mile out of the South Marina and then to the north a little bit. That's actually a test dam that they made when they were making the reservoir. And it's a fairly well-known area among walleye anglers. It's usually buoyed when the water is low so that people know to see it. If you're kind of a novice, look for the boats outside of the South Marina about a half mile. You'll find it from there. The deepest areas that you're going to see are along the western side. These right here are called the trenches. They're about 30 feet or a little bit deeper when the reservoir is at full pool. And then I don't know if you can really tell the color change from the TVs here, but as you get to the northern dike here, you see a little bit more of that blue. So those are your deeper areas. Then the eastern half is going to be the shallower of the two areas. Looking at it from the air, I wanted to just kind of highlight a few of the popular places. There's a lot more I could go into, but I'm not sure that I'm going to have time for that. But I kind of wanted to get you knowledgeable about Willard speak when it comes to where to fish. You've got the north dike up here. The reservoir doesn't, you know, run completely north-south, but it's close enough. You have the west dike over here, the south dike down here, and then the eastern dike is basically considered the area to the north and south of the South Marina. And then when you come up around to the northeast, we've got Freeway Bay, which is the area that's adjacent to the freeway. It's the closest you're going to get to I-15. That's kind of its own area. And then once you get up past that, you kind of quit having dike for a while, where it turns into basically beaches and areas along the perimeter of the state park. And so that's the North Marina and northeast corner up there. A few other areas to note, there's the inlet, which is directly to the east and south of the South Marina. They're actually connected. You can't run a boat up there from the South Marina. They won't let you do that, but you can fish from shore, and that's a popular area in the spring. Then another landmark is going to be the light pole, which is basically about by the intersection of the north dike and the west dike. It's pretty sad when a light pole sticks out as a landmark, but the dike is pretty similar all along, and so that's one that anglers use. There's a little bit of topography around there, too, that people key in on. Let's talk forage fish. There's really three species in my mind that make up the forage base. As we talked about, the shad are the dominant one, and I'll devote a whole slide to them. But there's a couple others in there that are worth knowing, which is the spot-tail shiner and the log perch. These two fish, they get to be anywhere between a couple inches to even up to 5 or 6 inches long. They're not present in as large numbers as the gizzard shad, but they're also a species that some of these fish key in on, particularly in the early spring. And then the other part of the forage base is going to be young carp and juvenile sport fish. They're also vulnerable too. Just kind of a neat fact about the log perch here. That's actually a member of the purset family. That's the same family as walleye and yellow perch. You can kind of think of it as a mini walleye. They also belong to the darter category. If you're from the Midwest or the Southeast, there's hundreds of different species of these. They're really colorful, pretty neat fish. Talking gizzard shad, they serve as the dominant forage fish. Got a picture of an adult one held up here. They can get to be anywhere from about 16 to 20 inches long when they're adults. They're highly prolific. They spawn each year multiple times, and their young basically provide the food during the summer months, fall, and then into the winter. One thing that's interesting with these guys is we're actually at the northern end of their habitable range, and what that means is we're kind of at the top of the latitudes at which they can tolerate the cold. And so it's actually suspected that the young of the year, so those young ones produced each year, actually experience 100% die-off during a lot of winters. They just don't have the ability to acclimate to the cold when they're young. If they can make it through that first year and get a mild winter, they can survive each of the winters thereafter as adults, but when they're young, they're fairly susceptible to basically rolling over during the winter. I've been monitoring the fishery this spring. It looks like our shad rolled over during the winter time. There are actually reports of some of them dead along the marinas. And so what that means for anglers, though, is that during the springtime, it's a good time because the fish are hungry. They've been feeding hard during the winter, but as that spring goes on, fishing can get really hot, and that's one of the reasons. They're zooplanktivores. What that means is they got a small mouth, a lot of filters in their behind their mouth as well, and basically they're just picking small things out of the water called zooplankton. And they travel in schools in open water, and that's an important concept which will influence where the fish are at certain times of year. Let's talk catching walleye through the seasons. I'm going to divide spring up into really two distinct seasons. I could probably even divide it up into three. The first one, though, is going to be the pre-spawn and spawn, and then the second one is going to be the post-spawn. Let's talk pre-spawn and spawn. I kind of group these two together because the fish are doing about the same thing during those two times. A lot of times what they're doing is they're staging, and they're staging in areas that are near where they want to spawn. This is a real great time of year, particularly if you're a shore angler, because walleye come in shallow and spawn in just a few feet of water. One of the other great things about it is a lot of times they're spawning along the dikes of Willard Bay. They particularly like the South Dike and the West Dike and kind of that southwest area. And there's actually a road that kind of circumnavigates the southern and western portion of the reservoir. And so anglers that are limited to the shore, you can drive along that road and basically hop up over the dike in the area that you want. They also, there's a certain amount of our fishery stock of walleye that run up the inlet. And a lot of times, a lot of anglers concentrate on that area during that time of year. So we have a reservoir spawning stock and we have an inlet spawning stock. Seems like they'll kind of mix it up depending upon the year or two. If the inlet flows aren't that good, we'll see more fish spawning along the reservoir. If the inlet flows are really good and they don't have good habitat along the reservoir shoreline, then more of them will hit the inlet. But there's lots of options for shore anglers during that time of year. There's lots of options for boat anglers too. You've got access to these areas as well. Another thing to think about, timing can increase success. We talked a little bit about night fishing. Those males are staging during the day, so they're getting near the area that they want to spawn in. Kind of like humans, males are always ready to go, so they're there first, basically waiting for the females to come in. The females only pretty much come in at night to do what they need to do. They're kind of in and out. And one of the things that I've kind of learned over the years is those females supposedly come in for about 4 hours to spawn, and they can either do it all at once in 4 hours, or they may actually come in for about an hour at a time over multiple nights. But with them basically doing their spawning activity at dark, what that means is that peak activity is generally from the time it gets dark till about midnight, because once that 4 hour period's over with, they're generally done. That doesn't mean you can't catch fish after that, it just means that your probably best bet is to go from dusk until a little bit later and after that. Post-spawn, I'm not gonna go into a whole lot on the time immediately after the spawn, because I think even really good anglers may not have that figured out. I don't know, Eljay, maybe you do, but that one's kind of a confusing time. A lot of times it seems like the fish have got a little bit of lockjaw, they're resting, they're recuperating. One of the things I will say is, though, they're generally looking for warmer water and a little bit of food during that time. It's really hard to predict where they're going to be, because during the spring you've got storms and then you've got calm, clear days, and those will push them to different areas. If you get a windy day, fish are generally going to follow that wind. The warmer water on the surface is going to get pushed around by the wind, so if you can handle the wind, go to the shoreline that the wind is blowing into. That water is going to be crashing into there, it's going to be stirring things up a little bit, and the warmer water is going to be there. Not only that, walleye like feeding in low light, and so that little bit of turbulence there is going to kind of muck up the water. That's going to give them low light, and then also as the water's a little bit darker, that absorbs more sunlight, that's going to be your warmer water. On those clear days, if the water's a little bit clearer, because those walleye like the low light, they'll be in a little bit deeper water. So it's going to kind of change day to day. Let's talk post-spawn as you get later into the months. I'm going to kind of lump together about mid-April through June. This is some of the best walleye fishing of the year. This is when, if you're kind of a novice and just kind of looking to get your legs under you, this is the time when a lot of people can go and catch walleye. Some of the prime spots are going to include areas where it warms up quickly and that have a little bit of shallow water topography. That's going to be Freeway Bay, the island, the north side, the northeast corner. That's got kind of some humps and dips. And then windblown shores are going to be ones to try. Also, I'm going to back up one moment here too and say anything I say here is plan A. You know, these fish are probably going to make a liar out of me eventually. I'm giving you the best bet, and then once that fails, go ahead and try something that I didn't say. So Willard is particularly fickle, and you can have good days and you can have bad days no matter how much you fished it. But these are kind of the best bets or plan A that I'm giving you. Summertime. Hot weather kind of slows fishing a little bit. Walleye are cool water fish. So when you get to be the heat of summer, fishing's gonna be better in the early morning, early evening. You got that low light and you get a little bit cooler surface temperatures. The appearance of those shad can also slow fishing. As I was mentioning, a lot of times the young die off. That means fish are fairly hungry. But by about midsummer or when you get into late spring, the shad generally start their spawning about mid-April. There's really nothing to feed on though for another month or two because those shad need time to grow. By about late June, they're getting to be about gumball size, and that's when those fish are really going to start feeding on them. And when they start getting full and have a lot of forage available, that's when fishing's going to slow down. That's when your presentation's going to have to be a little bit better. But that time before in spring is generally pretty good. Summer slows down. Your best bets are going to be the trenches on the west side. That's a little bit deeper water. The island seems to be a good one even during the middle of summer. And then open water. And I know that's pretty general, but those young shad move around in large schools. The fish community in Willard is really suited to open water. And so what those fish will be doing, whether they're wiper or walleyes, they're going to be chasing those schools of shad around. What that means is you may have to go looking for them. You might have to troll a lot. And if you do find them, you probably can't guarantee that they'll be there even a few hours later or the next day, so you might have to find them again. One other thing that I'm going to add, too, I think it was Dan that mentioned pressure. You know, fish again will prove me wrong, but a lot of times with Willard, they get turned off by these storms. I know some anglers that won't go out until there's about 3 days of high pressure. That's when some of the better fishing seems to be. So just a tip on that one. And then let's talk fall. It's kind of like spring. You know, the water's starting to cool down. You're going to be looking for those areas that are a little bit shallower, have a little bit of topography. The only difference is that you're going to have shad around at this point, so you're going to get the still fish with lures that imitate those shad. You can probably divide fall into early fall and late fall. In early fall, the shallow water is going to be the warmest because it's getting that daylight and sun. It's going to be cooler at night. So I'm kind of talking more early fall here. You're going to be Freeway Bay, the island, the north side, the northeast corner, and those windblown shores again. If you fish later into fall, you're going to want to focus on deeper areas because that's going to be where that warmer water is. So I want to give a little bit on presentations by the season too. And just kind of talk about what might work. And again, once these lures that you try don't work, go off on your own and try something different because Willard may wreck what I tell you. But early spring, your best bet are going to be things that you can work slow. So jigs, which is like curly tails, some plastics, worm harnesses coupled with those bottom bouncers that LJ showed you, something you can work really slow. Crankbaits can work, but you're going to have to work really slow. And the other thing is, with those shad not potentially being around, you might do a little bit better with brighter colors, something that's not necessarily an imitation of shad. And also, a more slender bait might work. You remember those darters and spot-tail shiners I showed you? Those are around. Those are available forage, but those shad are not. So you might do better imitating those fish than you would a shad. Later in the season, when you get to spring, that kind of April through mid-June period, crankbaits start to become more effective. You can run them a little bit faster during that time. One thing I'm going to suggest is smaller generally works better at that period. Those shad, if they have been spawned, aren't that big yet. So you might find that like the normal 3-inch lipless crankbait here is a little bit too big of a presentation. All when I'm out trolling, I'll go down to a 2-inch one, and generally I can be fairly effective with that. Spinners and bottom bouncing still work well through that season too. It just kind of depends upon how warm that water is. If it's colder, you want to work a little bit slower like LJ was suggesting. If it's warmer, you might have a little more leeway and can pick up the speed. Summer, I say crankbaits. You can work those fast. You got a lot of different varieties, and the shad are going to be about like what's in this picture here, probably about 3 inches long in the middle of summer. Anything that imitates a shad can be pretty good. I put one of the baits that I use pretty commonly over here, which is kind of a jointed shad wrap. It's kind of suspending. Willard is not a very deep water, and so you don't have to dive real deep with your bait to cover a lot of the water column. Right now, the average depth out in the middle of the bay is probably about 10 feet. And so if you have a bait that dives down 5 to 7 feet, you're covering a lot of ground. If those fish are in the area, they're generally going to bite it. Those lipless crankbaits, like the one on the right here, work pretty well. Anything that looks like a shad, and then when that doesn't work, try something different. I was just talking with a buddy that said even in the middle of summer when all those shad run around, he was doing great on shad wraps and lipless cranks. Didn't do well after that, and he switched to those slender baits, knocked them dead for a little while. So be flexible. Come with a plan A, but have materials ready for plan B too. Then in the fall, just like with the seasonal areas they'll be holding, you kind of go back to those other baits. Crankbaits and more shad imitations will work. Jigs will work. Those spinners and bottom bouncers will work. You'll just want to slow down your presentation as that water cools. Want to give a research update. Paul actually handled some of the spawning activity, so I won't go into length on that, but I want to tell you about another study that we're doing that's been pretty neat and exciting, not only for us, but I think should hold a little bit of excitement for you anglers. Basically, over the past couple years, I've been engaged in a walleye stocking feasibility study with Willard Bay. We haven't traditionally stocked walleye in the past. We haven't really had a program to stock walleye in Utah. What we did, we stocked 500,000 walleye fry in the spring of 2015. we chemically marked those fish. We wanted a way to basically distinguish the fish that we stocked from those that were naturally reproduced. And this picture at the bottom of the screen is actually a picture of some of those fry. They're, I think, about 3 days old when we received them. We actually got them from Colorado Parks and Wildlife. And they're basically, they're in their bath right now. That's their chemical bath that basically gives them a mark that we can detect later. When we catch them again in the fall, they're still what we consider young of the year. This is after about anywhere from 6 to 8 months. Those fish are little cigars. They're about 8 to 10 inches long, sometimes a little bit longer. That's what they look like. Last fall, when we did our trend ending, we sampled a lot of these young fish. That was indicative of a strong year class, which is what we like to see. Walleye go through cycles. You know, even if we kept that stocking amount constant, we probably wouldn't get as good a result year after year. But we saw a strong year class, and that was good because that gave us a good sample of fish to look at and see how we were doing. Of those fish sampled, 88% displayed that mark, which meant those were fish that we stocked. That was really good results. We saw about 12% of those were naturally reproduced, though, as well, which is also good to see, which is there's some background reproduction going on. But this is big news. Supplemental stocking of this type, where you already have a naturally reproducing population in the reservoir, is not often successful. Fishery biologists have studied it around the nation. It's generally successful in about 6% of cases. So we did not go into this study thinking that this would work. But basically what this suggests is that Willard Bay is one of those odd cases where the supplemental stocking might work. One of the reasons it doesn't often work is if you already have a naturally reproducing population. Walleye are what we call highly fecund. They produce a lot of eggs. Females produce about 40 to 60,000 on average. They put a lot of spawning material out there. And sometimes if they don't make it based on that, there just might be other factors that we can't override by stocking, such as predation. It could be weather, environmental things. There's a lot of factors at play there, and so that stocking doesn't always work, but in this case it did. This is just year one out of 3 years that we're gonna be doing this study, though. Could be it doesn't work next year. We'll see. But right now we've got some really encouraging results. And the implications of this are pretty big. What it means is we may now actually have another tool in our toolbox here at the Division of Wildlife for managing these walleye. So we might actually be able to create successful year classes when natural reproduction fails or is inadequate some years. The other neat thing about this is that it actually kind of helps us deduce where the bottleneck is with these fish. You know, we've known our Willard Bay walleye population has been prone to booms and busts and sometimes goes a long time without a good year class. And as I mentioned, those walleye lay hundreds of millions of eggs each year. But if we can put in 500,000 fry, which is a pretty paltry amount, a small amount, and have a lot of success with those fish coming back, what that kind of tells us is that the bottleneck or the weak link may be in the egg stage where we're not experiencing very good survival of those eggs. So this gave us a little bit more of a clue about what's going on with the fishery itself and reproduction of those walleye as well. And then Paul covered the walleye spawning. I was going to go over that, but somebody asked about the procedure there. There's a picture of us actually spawning fish at the reservoir there. And I think that's probably all I need to cover on that end, since we already covered the walleye spawning pretty well. So thanks for the time, and if I have time for questions, I'm happy to take them. So, sure. Okay, so the question was about the raising of the dike and whether or not they would be putting a pump in the Bear River to pump water into the lake. I haven't heard of any plans for that. There's been talk by Weber Basin about putting in other reservoirs in the Bear River drainage, but nothing about pumping water into Willard Bay just yet. Right back here.
Now, what times do they begin to spawn? Like, what is that time phase?
Sure. So the question was, what time do these fish spawn? What's kind of the general time frame? It definitely depends by year. You know, as you can imagine, it's going to change on, you know, when ice out is, what the average temperatures are. But most years, they generally begin about mid-March. Sometimes it's early as late February, but I want to say mid-March is generally key. With all the netting that we've been doing out there, collecting walleye for the spawn, we think we're at about peak spawn right now. So we're potentially in the middle of it, or depending upon how the curve is with these guys, it could be it's just a peak and then it drops off really quick. I'm thinking they probably won't go much longer than another week or two. Some of our historical reports are that it generally goes to maybe the April 10th, maybe a little bit later. So that's kind of about the time frame.
So temperature affects that,
maybe? It does. However, the question was, does temperature affect it? Yes, it does. However, biology is pretty messy, and there's never been a distinct link where it's just temperature or just day of year. It's always kind of a suite of factors that influence these fish, and being able to hone exactly in on that, we haven't been able to over the years. We just know it's kind of a combination of temperature, day of year, which generally means how much sunlight do you get, and then it can be other things, other cues like precipitation and inflow into that reservoir, where basically the more of that fresh water you get in there, the more dilute the water gets, and basically the water chemistry changes. And so we haven't pinned it down to one thing, but we've kind of got that general date range down. I'm gonna pick back there, and I apologize, I'm not seeing how many hands are going up when, so I'm trying to get people as they come. So.
Okay, so the millions of dollars they spent on putting two more feet on top of the dike at Willard, that doesn't tell if it's gonna raise the water 10 more feet?
Sure. So the question was, what was the purpose of raising the dike at Willard Bay, and how high do they plan on filling it? Basically, Weber Basin and the Bureau of Reclamation, particularly Weber Basin, has an obligation to provide, I think it's 250,000 acre feet of water to water users. Right now, Willard is holding, I think, something on the order of 250,000 acre feet, and they're looking for ways to develop more water so that they're meeting water demand into the future. Willard Bay was an easy way to get that more water for their users. And so what they've done by raising the dike there is they've gained the capacity to hold more water when we get the really, really good water years. Because in the really good water years, Willard Bay fills and then they're bypassing water and it's going out to basically Willard Bay proper, which is the freshwater wetland area going into the Great Salt Lake. It doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to fill it this year, but it means in the good water years they're going to be able to store more water. And one of the key things with that is you wouldn't think it would make that big of a difference, but I believe it was Weber Basin did some modeling, and they projected that had they had that extra 2 feet on top of the dike over the past 20 years, Willard Bay would have filled 7 more times in the past 20 years because they would have had that extra storage capacity to capture water when the getting's good, basically. So. Do I have more time?
We got time for about two more.
Okay, in the back in the hat.
So, there's a picture here. Is there a, the size of walleye to keep caught nice and healthy? Is that important?
I'm gonna say no. I'm sorry, let me repeat the question. The question was, is there a size to keep on walleye to protect the population? Not necessarily. I do understand we do have regulations that protect fish that are generally over 24 inches. But by and large, the consensus among biologists is it really doesn't matter. Those females do produce a lot of eggs, but so do the medium-sized females. I mean, you're talking, four of the average fish will produce probably 240,000 eggs. One of those large females might produce 200,000. So it really doesn't make a whole lot of difference genetics-wise as well. It's good though from a catch and release or a sportsman's ethics standpoint, where if people want to preserve large fish for others to catch, that would be the main reason. But from a protecting spawning standpoint, not necessarily. Hope that answers it. Yes?
This might be off the subject, but is it better, I wanted to go out there and catch cat with channel cat. Is the best place by the big farm?
Good question.
Is it good all year there, or is it just in the fall?
Okay, so the question was a good time and place to catch channel catfish at Willard Bay. Basically by the farm there, what we call the feedlot, is a very good area. I've had good luck as well, just outside of the North Marina, a couple hundred yards. Catfish, let me back up and say the population of Willard Bay is doing very, very well. Some fish benefit from the low water, others don't. Catfish are one of those that have benefited pretty good from it. Basically, they need warmer spawning temperatures than any other fish. They need warmer water temperatures, and they like basically spawning along the interface of where that dike, so those big boulders, meet the bottom of the reservoir. And if you're a fish that spawns with warmer temperatures and that water's drawn down, you get earlier access to spawning activity because the water's gonna warm quicker, and then you get access to shallower water to spawn, which is gonna warm up quicker as well. So those catfish have benefited. We've seen some really good year classes come through. The population's doing great. I'm a little bit of a catfish angler myself. I've done really well outside North Marina. I've done really well outside the South Marina. I've done really well near the feedlot there. I really haven't pinned down where they are. What I generally do is just go drift for a while and see what I can do. If you're a shore angler, play the time of day. You know, catfish can be caught during the day, but your best bets are gonna be early morning and early evening because the general pattern of catfish is gonna be that they go out deeper during the day and then they come in shallow at night to feed. And so that's kind of the pattern to hone in on. And then through the seasons, play up that warmer water, which means play on that eastern side during the spring and fall where that's gonna warm up a little bit quicker, and that'll benefit you.
Thanks, Chris.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Well, that wraps up our presentations for the evening. Dan Smith from Fish Tech was nice enough to bring a few hats for some kids here. So if kids would like to raise your hands, we'll try and get you a hat. We got about seven or eight of them, so we're gonna hope we got less than seven or eight kids raise their hands. Okay? There you go, bud. Keep your hand up. Okay, and while those are being passed out, everybody get your raffle tickets. Rocky Mountain Anglers has got two trips? Two trips that they're going to give away. Yeah.
Okay, get your raffle tickets out. I'm Skip Name. I'm currently the president of Rocky Mountain Anglers. And could we get my sheet up here, whatever.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. What I want to direct your attention to before we have the drawing is we want to invite you to take a look at our website and our Facebook page. We would love you, love to have you come out to our meetings. What you've seen tonight, we have a Reader's Digest presentation each and every month, and a second Tuesday of the month in Murray. And it's wide open. It's anglers from all experiences, and we just have a great time. We share information. We tell each other, you know, if you've been out fishing, what's hot, what's working, what's not, and it's really increased a lot of our catch rates. So if you're interested, take a look at our website. Write it down. We have all the contact information on there. Applications, everything that you would need, and we'd love to see you come out. Okay, so with that, we're going to have the drawing. Hold that a second. Let me get my glasses on.